Good morning. Good afternoon. Or good evening. It doesn't matter what time of night or day. I'm still just as glad that you stopped by my channel. If we're meeting for the first time, my name's Reverend Paul J. Bern. I'm the online pastor of the online church known as the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, based in Atlanta, Georgia, sending blog posts and videos around the world. This is a church that's not a church. You won't find any brick and mortar here. We are online only. You won't find any denominational teachings here. No teaching of one religion as being any better than another. No political ideology either. None of those things. No pomp and circumstance. No dogma. No theology. No, you won't find any of that, but what you will find is Jesus Christ, the Son of God, crucified, died, and resurrected on the morning of that third day, that magnificent morning, and who now sits as his Father's right hand, waiting for the command to come and get us. We eagerly wait for that day, precious Lord. Yes, we do indeed. Eagerly waiting. But in the meantime, it's time for another installment of my ongoing biblical study series of the writings of the Apostle Luke. We are in the book of Acts, chapter 23. This would be part 3, verses 23 through 35. You'll find part 1 and part 2 in the listing of all the videos that I've recorded. It's in there. But for right now, let's talk about the Apostle Paul and his captivity at the hands of the Roman Empire. But as you saw or read last week, is all for his own protection. And so the Apostle Paul is transferred, is the title of this message, is transferred to Caesarea under guard. Now Caesarea was a fishing village about 110 miles north of Jerusalem. And with that in mind, let's go ahead and get started here. Now, as I mentioned last week, as we left off at verse 22 of chapter 23, the Roman commander of the squadron in charge of making sure that Paul remained in their custody has just received some new intelligence. Paul the Apostle's nephew had overheard a conversation between some members of the Sanhedrin. These men were going to kill Paul themselves with no middlemen involved. Plot to kill Paul was an inside job right from the start. This is precisely what Paul's nephew had come and told him. Now, see verse 16 of last week's study. Verse 16 of Acts chapter 23, that is. The Lord, based on this development, the Lord selects the unlikeliest of people to do His will. I'm another example myself. I'm an un- unlikely individual to even be involved in the ministry in the first place. But that's a whole other story. For that story, you'll have to buy my book, Soul Survivor, which is available on Amazon for $18.95. It's only 100 pages, and it's a great read, inspirational through and through. But for now, as you recall, again, just a minute ago, Paul then sent his nephew, as you recall from last week, Paul then sent his nephew directly to his Roman captors to alert the commander of the murder plot against him, and that the commander was about to get played by the religious elect in Jerusalem, the leaders of the temple, the religious establishment of their day. To this day, I am convinced that Paul's nephew being at the right place at the right time to gather that critical piece of intelligence about the plot against his uncle was not coincidental. No way. In point of fact, the Lord God Almighty can sometimes work in very mysterious ways, and he uses those who one would least expect to carry out his commands. And so, as we begin this week's lesson, the Roman commander wastes no time in making his decision as to what to do with Paul next. And that's where we'll start up here for this week's study at verse 23. Going to go all the way to verse 30 and stop there. And I quote, "Then he called the commander. He called two of his centurions and ordered them, get ready a detachment of 200 soldiers, 70 horsemen, and 200 spearmen to go to Caesarea at 9 tonight. Provide horses for Paul so that he may be taken safely to Governor Felix." He wrote a letter as follows, verse 26. "Claudius Lysias to His Excellency Governor Felix, greetings. This man was seized by the Jews, and they were about to kill him. But I came with my troops and rescued him, for I learned that he is a Roman citizen. I wanted to know why they were accusing him, so I brought him to their Sanhedrin. I found that the accusation had to do with questions about their law, but there was no charge against him that deserved death or imprisonment. When I was informed of the plot to be carried out against the man, I sent him to you at once. I also ordered his accusers to present to you their case against him." Close quote. Now, let's break this down one sentence or two at a time here. Paul the Apostle is evacuated under cover of darkness. There can be no doubt that the Roman commander at Jerusalem was very serious about making sure his orders were carried out with finesse, as you saw in verse 23. He was also a man who believed in taking care of details, so he amassed a formidable force to escort the Apostle Paul to Caesarea on the assumption that the Sanhedrin would hire mercenaries to kill Paul by attacking those escorting him, and put Paul on a horse for his own safety as well. While the troops were being assembled, the commander pens, or possibly dictates, a letter of explanation to Felix, the Roman governor of Caesarea and the surrounding territory of which they were part. Verses 26 through 30 comprise the letter sent there by the Roman commander. So now, let's move on to part two of this week's lesson, beginning at verse 31, and I quote, "So the soldiers, carrying out their orders, took Paul with them during the night and brought him as far as Antipatris," or Antipatris, I think is how that's pronounced. "The next day they let the cavalry go on with him, while they returned to the barracks. When the cavalry arrived in Caesarea, they delivered the letter to the governor and handed Paul over to him. The governor read the letter and asked what province he was from. Learning that he was from Cilicia, he said, 'I will hear your case when your accusers get here.' Then he ordered that Paul be kept under guard in Herod's palace." Okay, so Paul's Roman appointed security detail is what this is all about. We see in verses 31 and 32 that Paul was escorted to Antipatris, a little town about halfway to their destination. He was held there until daylight for his own safety, until he could be escorted the rest of the way to Caesarea by the armed Roman contingent. Caesarea was about 100 kilometers, or about 63 miles, north of Jerusalem. They presumably needed more soldiers during the night for security reasons. Even the Judea-based contingent of guards sent by their commander waited until the following morning before returning to their barracks in Jerusalem. See verse 32. Life back then was very dangerous indeed, and so it's no wonder that the human lifespan was so much shorter back then than it is now. The Apostle Paul, however, has found himself in much better accommodations. In verses 33 and 34, the governor Felix receives the two centurions and their complements of troops from Jerusalem along with the Apostle Paul. Reading the letter from the Roman commander, he asks Paul where he's from, and I quote here, "Learning that he was from Cilicia, he said, 'I will hear your case when your accusers get here.' And then he ordered that Paul be kept under guard in Herod's palace," close quote. So evidently, Governor Felix had previous experience with the clique within the temple at Jerusalem's hierarchy. Based on his response to Paul, Claudius had taken a wait-and-see attitude about the whole affair, knowing full well that Paul's accusers were a bunch of hypocrites. For details on that, see Matthew chapter 23. I believe it's the first 20 verses, if my memory's right. Spells it all out right there for you. But for now, Paul is placed under guard in Herod's palace in verse 35. And it was likely a much better place than the soldiers' barracks at Jerusalem or the cell in which he had previously been held. And so, Paul's fate hangs in the balance. And this is where I can conclude this, pardon me, for right now. So the Apostle Paul remains in Roman custody pending his hearing with Felix and his former compatriots from Jerusalem. What will be said? How will the hearing proceed while the Jewish temple delegation is presenting their case? What new evidence for any new charges does the Sanhedrin-affiliated consortium have against Paul? If they have no new evidence, Paul walks away a free man. If the Sanhedrin affiliates have new evidence against Paul, what is its nature? To find out Paul's fate, and everything else. Be sure and return next week for part one of Acts chapter 24. As my ongoing series on the writings of the Apostle Paul continues. Since you must have liked this because you watched it all the way through to the end, come and join me for unlimited access to my blog. Sign up for a membership. It can be found on WordPress, on Medium, and on Substack. You can search for Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, or just Social Gospel, and it'll come right up there for you. Well, it should. If that doesn't work, search my name, Reverend Paul J. Bern. It's B-E-R-N. That's how you spell my last name, okay? And you'll get a response that way. Now, normally at the end of the service here, this is the part where the church passes around a collection plate. Well, I don't have a physical church, so I don't bother with the collection plate. Moreover, you will never ever hear me ask you to please tithe 10% of your income. I don't teach that. Tithing is in the Bible in the Old Testament, yes. But it was done under totally different circumstances than now. I've got another one written up on that, or recorded on the channel here. But the consequences for that. So I don't ask for 10%. In fact, if you have no money to give me, I don't ask you for anything at all. Except that I hope this message blessed you and heartened you and encouraged you. I do however have expenses, office expenses for marketing, and I'm trying to raise $1,000 or so together for an ad campaign. But I do that with donations. If you are able, I would appreciate it. You can donate on PayPal. The address on PayPal is as follows: greatestservant62@gmail.com. That's all one word, all lowercase. greatestservant62@gmail. That's all there is to that. You can also donate on Stripe if you like, if you prefer that one. Some say Stripe's easier. Go to Stripe.com, their homepage, and type in the search box, Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center, and it'll pop right up for you, fill in the amount, and send it off. Same as with PayPal. All donations are held in the strictest confidence, and all donations go directly to the Social Gospel Worship and Learning Center. I do not take a salary for doing this. I do this for free. And so, before you go, please don't forget to give me a like if you enjoyed this, and I trust you did. If you really liked it, to give me a share or two would be even better. Best of all, you can subscribe, and the subscription is free. To sign up, all you got to do is to click the subscribe button, and on the middle left-hand side of your screen right there, you'll see it. It's black with white lettering. And just click that, and you'll get the stuff sent to your inbox. Every time something new comes up, you can subscribe to the blog on Substack at pbern, that's pbern.substack.com. Substack is S-U-B-S-T-A-C-K. It's $5 a month or $50 a year. for the paid version of the blog. You get a lot of extras for that, such as access to my archives, which are considerable. Good deals on books, faith-based t-shirts, faith-based books too, actually, I should have said. And later on this year, there will be a calendar promotion for selling 2024 calendars. We'll put those up for sale in the fall. They're going to be antique automobiles, all of them. One calendar for each make. A Dodge calendar, a Plymouth, a Chrysler, a Chevy, a Pontiac, an Olds, a Mercury, a Lincoln. And let's not forget the Corvettes and the Thunderbirds. So, it's all in there. You'll love it when it come out. Sale price on those is going to be somewhere in the neighborhood of $19.95 as of right now. I'm working to see if I can get that price down a little bit before I release it. That's why I'm looking for another supplier right now. But enough about that. I want to sincerely thank you all before I go for the privilege of your time. You are all ever so much appreciated. And having said all there is to say, everyone be blessed. Yes, I said be blessed. In Jesus' mighty name.